I think grace is not. There might be a button you need to click to turn it on. I'm not sure. But if you're having any problems with the sound system, perhaps let our colleagues at the back know. Okay. So good afternoon, everyone. And thank you very much for joining us here today. My name is Reagan Pyromahakit, and I work at RECOFT, the Regional Community Forestry Training Center for Asia and the Pacific. And we're delighted to be here today, and I would like to give my thanks to the hosts for today, the Canadian government, as well as the Prince Albert II of Monaco Foundation, and IFSA, the International Forest Students Association, for supporting this session. RECOFT comes to this event by virtue of hosting the Secretariat for the Regional Model Forest Network, which is generously supported by the Canadian government. The Model Forest Network is a long-standing initiative which is aimed at cultivating best practices for sustainable forest management by local communities in sites globally. And RECOFT hosts the Secretariat for Asia Pacific. So you will be aware that the theme of today is women, children and youth, and Indigenous people. And I am confident that the speakers that we have today will be able to make meaningful contributions to the discussion of this topic and hopefully advance our thinking and our understanding of perspectives around it. We will hear viewpoints and perspectives on Indigenous forest management, gender and youth. And I think that an interesting element of today's session and the two panels is the exchange of learnings from the north to the south. In addition, we'll be incorporating alternative viewpoints and perspectives, such as the engagement of Indigenous people, gender in conservation from the perspective of the International Rangers Federation. So, without further ado, let me call on our first panel to take their seats on the stage. So that's Mr. Wendell Trio. And perhaps I can ask you to sit on the opposite sides of the screen because one of our panelists is joining us virtually. Ms. Mumta Lama. And we'll have our online participant, Ms. Valerie Courtois. Hello, Valerie. So the theme of the first of our two panels in today's session is on Indigenous people's knowledge and rights in forest conservation. What I would like to do is ask each of our distinguished panelists to introduce themselves, what their role is, and then what their work is and how it contributes to this theme of IP knowledge and rights in forest management. So please try and keep this to within about 5 minutes. So Wendell, would you kindly kick us off introducing yourself and the work that you do?
Yes, thank you, Reagan, and thank you for the organizers for inviting me to this very interesting event. My name is Wendell Trio. I'm here representing the Global Forest Coalition, which is a coalition of NGOs worldwide that work on forest protection and that have just recently published the Baku Forest Declaration, which is a declaration that has been developed by groups from the region here, the Caucasus and Central Asia. And that brings me to the project that I'm actually working on. I'm coordinating the Northern Forests and Climate Change Project, which is a coalition of NGOs, scientists, and Indigenous peoples representatives, kind of fighting to get greater recognition for northern forests inside this climate change process. Because most of the time when people speak about forests, they speak about tropical forests, putting a lot of responsibility with developing countries to fight deforestation. which is important. And of course, that needs recognition and support, including financial support. But it's also important for developed countries, the industrialized countries, to recognize that they also have an important part of the world's global forest cover. Over 40% of the world's forests are actually located in the Northern Hemisphere, with most of them actually in Canada, the US, Alaska, Russia, and the European Union, the Scandinavian part. These four countries that I said represent over 90% of the northern forests. And all in all, northern forests are extremely important in terms of climate change, because they hold almost 50% of the global forest carbon that is stored. So almost 50% of that. They are, of course, increasingly important in terms of biodiversity, because the last stretches of primary and old growth forests are to be found in the northern forest. But more importantly for the item here, they are also home to a wide range of indigenous peoples, often not so visible as many of the indigenous peoples in tropical forests, but also extremely important, you know, groups like the Diné, Innu, the Inuit, but also the Sami in Europe, and Yukats, etc. So there's a whole range of indigenous peoples all across this polar circle, let's say. And it's very clear that indigenous peoples play an important role in forest conservation. We know that from multiple studies that when forests are being conserved, protected, managed by indigenous peoples, that there's much higher levels of biodiversity, much higher levels of carbon stored, etc. So the issue of land rights becomes extremely important in that. And there is a problem that needs to be addressed, in the sense that despite the fact that northern forests are extremely important for climate, biodiversity, and indigenous peoples, they're actually not so highly protected. I mean, only 10% of northern forests have some kind of protected status, either as a nature reserve, as an indigenous peoples territory, while compared to developing countries, that's between 25 to 30%. So there's still a long way to go. And that's one of the things that we clearly want to see. We want greater protection of the northern forest, and we want greater recognition of indigenous people's land rights in these northern forests to ensure that we can better conserve them, and that they can play a greater role in climate protection, biodiversity protection, and human rights protection. Thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you very much. Okay, and with that, I believe we will move to Mamta Lama. Can you please introduce yourself and the work that you're doing with the ICVCM?
Hi, everyone. My name is Mamta Lama, and I serve as the indigenous member of the Indigenous Peoples and Local Communities Forum at the ICVCM, which is also known as Integrated Council for Voluntary Carbon Market. This forum was recently launched in June in 2024, and this is a new initiative that we are taking on as part of the need of within the voluntary carbon market. There are so many conversations going on, you know, in terms of the need for better representation and better inclusion of indigenous peoples, because they are a very important component of the voluntary carbon market. So we want to champion their voices to be heard within the voluntary carbon market, and not just hearing their voice from around the globe, but also making sure that we have a strategy going forward and basically influencing the standards, and also for them to have the capacity to better decide, and not just better decide, but also be part of the voluntary carbon market as a partner within that mechanism of benefit sharing. So we're trying to do that. We're developing strategies, and that's what we're trying to do from the forum. Thank you. Yeah, that's what I'm...
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mamta. If anyone is having any issues hearing, please perhaps raise your hand so that we can give you a new headset. And with that, I would like to turn to Valerie and to invite you to kindly introduce yourself, the work you do, and how it responds to Indigenous rights and knowledge.
Thank you very much for this opportunity to join you virtually. I hope you can hear me well. I'm in Goose Bay, Labrador, which is in the extreme northeast part of what is now known as Canada. My name is Valérie Courtois. I'm the executive director of the Indigenous Leadership Initiative, which is the only national scope Indigenous-led conservation organization in Canada. The work that we do is that we promote not only the role in decision-making of Indigenous nations right across this country, but in particular the role of stewardship and how that is an important aspect of Indigenous people's assertions of our rights and titles here in what is now known as Canada. Some of you may know that we've been on quite a journey in this country of recognition of rights and titles. And as a result, we have a number of Indigenous nations who have expressed their and asserted their rights to manage forests and landscapes and waterscapes here in Canada. And in fact, the only viable pathway for the country of Canada to achieve its international commitments with respect to the conservation of biodiversity is by enabling that leadership by Indigenous peoples. In fact, currently there is more than 500 million square kilometers in proposed protected areas by nations across Canada, which is essentially the gap that there is to fill for Canada to achieve its international commitments in biodiversity conservation. In addition to that, there are now over 200 Indigenous guardian programs. These programs are managed by individual nations and designed to implement our Indigenous laws and policy with respect to the management of forests and landscapes and waterscapes, but also to be an interlocutor with other land users and other governments in terms of the management of that forest and of those forests. And right now, we have well over 1,500 guardians who are employed across the country. Some of the exciting work that has emerged most recently is the Project Finance for Permanence partnerships. There are four underway in Canada, two of which have concluded their partnerships. The most recent one, which my organization was the convener for, is the Northwest Territories, Our Lands for Our Future initiative, which will contribute at least 2% of the national target in terms of protection and create hundreds of guardians jobs. This is a private-public partnership that was announced just last week, last Thursday, and is $375 million Canadian that will go into the region of the Northwest Territories, which will vastly transform the nature of not only Indigenous-led stewardship and conservation in the region, but in fact provide a basis for a new model of economics in that region that is much more balanced with the reality of the need of protection of these landscapes and forestscapes. And why this matters is because Canada really has one of the largest intact forests left on this planet, which is the boreal forests of Canada. Those forests store more than twice as much carbon per hectare as tropical forests do. We have a fifth of the world's remaining fresh water, a quarter of the world's remaining wetlands. It is the birthplace of 3 to 5 billion birds per year. If we are to think about the role of northern forests, as my fellow panelist Wendell pointed out, Canada is a place where we could really kind of make advances and demonstrate the value of trusting the leadership and the decision-making of Indigenous peoples in the management of forests. So thank you very much for this opportunity to join you.
It's wonderful, yes. Very exciting and powerful perspectives from the Indigenous communities in Canada. I think what we will do now is a second round of questions before we open it up to the floor to be able to comment and ask questions. So I'll direct this first to yourself, Wendell. What similarities and differences do you see in the defense of Indigenous rights between groups in the north, in the northern forest context, and in the south?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for that question. So, of course, to start with, every Indigenous nation is unique. Huh? They have all their own features and so on. So it's very important to recognize that. Now, it's also clear that Indigenous nations in their relationships with governments, that they can be very different. And of course, the situation in Canada is different than the situation in a land in a country as Ecuador or Peru or whatever. So there's clearly differences. Some Indigenous nations have treaties with governments. Some have even parliaments, like the Sami. They have a Sami parliament where they are kind of have a certain recognition of the role they play in government decisions and policies that directly affect them. So many of those things are not the case in southern countries. So that's a recognition to be made. But there's also a lot of similarities. And despite the different relationships with governments, I think all Indigenous peoples are struggling with getting their full rights recognized, with getting their lands being recognized. And when we talk about forest protection, recognition of Indigenous peoples' land rights is actually a crucial element. It's a cornerstone of making progress on forest protection. But also what we see in many cases and where there's similarities between Indigenous peoples, if not all, is that they start from a different point of view than many of the governments. Different point of view of how to look at the world, how to look at the environment, how to look at the forests. And that sometimes clashes, that different point of view between, let's say, traditional Western based governments as we know them in the northern forest. And it's important to recognize that. It's important to recognize that there's a different starting point, because if we don't recognize that, we will not come to any kind of fruitful agreement between Indigenous nations and the governments of the territories they're living in.
Great. Thank you, Wendell. The next question I'll direct to you, Mamta. What are your thoughts on the generational divide with regards to traditional ecological knowledge and the uptake of the next generation, the younger generation, of the way that their elders, previous generations, have lived and passed on knowledge? And what do you think can be done to allow for more of a transferring of knowledge between generations?
I would like to respond to that question by sharing my own story. I come from an indigenous Tamang community in Nepal, and then my grandfather used to be a resident of one of the rural communities in Nepal. And he actually moved to Kathmandu, but he still had that access to the knowledge of how the ecosystem resources works and how to best utilize the resources, whether it's adaptation to climate change impacts or whether it's the utilization of the herbs and those resources basically to adapt to some of the the medicinal practices as well. He also used to care some of the patients in the urban areas where the people don't have that much of financial access basically to afford the hospital's bills. So he used to support those people with curing those sort of illness, basically utilizing the herbs, and he had that knowledge. But after he passed away, I don't have access to that anymore. So I think there is a gap between intergenerational kind of transfer of those traditional ecological knowledge, and that is forever lost to me. And what can be done I think, is better recognition of the traditional ecological knowledge in policies, and also better integration of traditional ecological knowledge in climate initiatives, whether it's carbon projects, whether it's adaptation projects. And also, while we talk a lot about these financing, carbon financing, and channeling funds to the local communities, I think this considered very much when we design or when we design the initiatives or the projects, it should be better recognized if it's a co-design process, and if they are included within the free, prior, and informed consent process, allowing them to discuss in those processes of designing those initiatives. And the other thing is better documenting the traditional ecological knowledge, and organizing more programs in schools and universities, basically to let them know that this is very important. Because in my case, I think I distanced myself from that unintentionally, because I was inclined to modern education, university. So I think there should be some way to basically letting the students who go to universities and also to schools to better let them know that this is also important, and we should not be inclining away from these traditional ecological knowledges, and there should be better recognition within policies, and also better process and integration in all of the initiatives. Thank you.
Great, thank you. So some thoughts on what can be done to allow for that transfer and the capture and the persistence of traditional ecological knowledge to the youth. Valerie, we heard a little bit from you about some of the innovative or upcoming models around private-public partnerships, but it would be interesting to learn a little bit more about what is happening amongst the Guardians and Indigenous people in Canada, and what some of these models and approaches could be transferred, could be shared, could be considered by brethren in the South.
Sure, thank you very much for that question. So in addition to kind of the concept of Guardians landing in Canada, we, like many other regions, struggle with the financial backing of these models. And one of the things that we've done here in Canada is that we've created what's called the First Nations National Guardians Network. And so any of the public monies that are invested into the model of Guardians through our state governments can channel through an Indigenous decision-making process. Part of the advantage of that is that not only can we better ensure that those investments land, but we can also better track the value of those investments and how those investments in Indigenous-led conservation and stewardship or forest management also translate into other social benefits that have been an important struggle for peoples as we emerge from our colonial history as a country. So we know that when there are Guardians presence, not only does that create valuable in-community jobs, which are quite rare in many cases, but it can also really translate to other social economic values, like the increase access to education or decreased violence against women, the ability for our youth to hope for their future, which has also resulted in a reduction of rates of suicide. Some of you may not be aware, but Indigenous peoples in Canada still to this day have some of the highest suicide rates in the world. And so this is something that as Indigenous leaders, we need to address in everything that we do with respect to the relationship with those landscapes. So certainly having that public and Indigenous Peoples Partnership that really creates an air and a context of trust between the government of Canada and the Indigenous governments to make the right decisions on the ground. So that's a model that we hope will inspire other regions in certainly trusting the ability of Indigenous peoples to make better decisions on how those investments land on the ground and to make sure that we're tracking the impacts of those investments. The other thing that has been very interesting here in Canada is that in many ways there is a reality of management here where much of the management of these forests happen in centers and not so much very locally. I mean, there are a number of exceptions to that rule, of course, through individual forest companies that are doing management, et cetera, and some regional office. But for the most part, that is a centralized management system. And the reality of the forests is that even though we talk about our boreal region, there is a lot of diversity within that national region. And so, for example, where I am in Labrador, we're on the far northeast corner of the boreal. In many ways, we are almost like a boreal rainforest. Our fire cycles are quite long. In our cases, they can be 500 to 800 years long. Which means that the dynamics of the forests and the way that you manage those forests is quite distinct from the western part of the forest. And I mentioned the Northwest Territories. Some of you may know that last year there were some extensive forest fires.
Oh dear. Okay, there we go. You're back with us. Sorry, we lost you there for a minute, Valerie.
Okay. Well, I was referring to forest fires in the Northwest Territories and the serious rate of burning that the boreal forest is suffering, particularly in the western part of the forest. And many of us who are foresters are starting to think that the rate of fires in those regions is actually beyond the range of natural variability, which is quite concerning in terms of the changes for those landscapes and the impacts on species like caribou, and other species that we depend on for our food security as Indigenous peoples. So that is another movement that we're hoping to develop, is to have guardians play a much stronger role in fire response and management and prevention, not only in terms of responding directly to fires, but also implementation of cultural practices around our relationship to fire, including cultural burning, which is something that historically in the forest management sector in Canada has been suppressed for various reasons and is now coming back. Just to give you a sense of implications, there are more than 40% of communities that are evacuated as a result of large wildfires in Canada are Indigenous peoples. And we tend to be evacuated much longer than non-Indigenous communities for a variety of reasons: access to infrastructure, location and remoteness of our communities, etc. So it's a real opportunity for Canada to rethink the way that it manages fires by looking to the role of Indigenous peoples to do some of that response and management in place and much quicker than can be generated from provincial capitals or other management centers. So those are examples of some of the things that I think are very transferable to not only to other regions around the world, but certainly to other communities and other places here in what is now known as Canada.
Yeah, that's very insightful. That's wonderful. Recoft works on community-based fire management as well. So it would be great to be able to touch bases and learn from your experiences. I think we have time to open it up for a couple questions from the audience. Are there any questions for our panelists? Yes, please. Maybe I'll...
if we have an extra... Thank you very much. My name is Juliet Biao. I'm the director of the United Nations Forum on Forests. I don't have a question, but it's just a contribution. The issue of land rights, we've been talking about it for almost four decades now, and it's still a major constraint. And yet, we are not far from the deadline for reaching the global forest goals. We all know that the first global forest goals is really to achieve forest cover by 3% by 2030. How do we achieve that if we cannot have really the land right, especially for indigenous people, is a matter of fairness. Without land rights, how can they even attract investment in terms of reforestation, afforestation? So as a UN Forum on Forests, I think these are issues that can be brought to the technical session of the UN Forum on Forests, and the next one will be in May next year in New York, so that we can get insight from other countries to know how we can really address this issue when we are looking at accelerating the achievement of the global forest goals. I will also encourage you to submit your national reporting where this kind of issue can be highlighted, so that as a UN Forum on Forests, we can know how we can support you to really address those issues. Thank you.
Yeah, that's great. The underlying question or issue of land tenure, which we heard in the panel earlier today here, which was very much focused on land rights recognition for Indigenous people as well. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
Thank you very much. I'm Zwide from Malawi. To what extent are you involved in coming up with some of these forest management plans, if any? I mean, if at all you are involved, maybe you might want to share some insight into this one. Thank you.
I will have to skip that question because we're
not directly
involved in that kind of work. So, yeah.
Yeah, same for me. Not directly involved, but we look forward to basically engage with the indigenous peoples and local communities from forests across the globe, because we have 8 members within the forum representing from 8 regions across the globe. And if there is any sort of opportunity that we can contribute in the forest management plans, best include indigenous peoples and local communities within the decision-making processes. Obviously, we are looking forward to influencing the policies in that regards. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Valerie, would you like to take a stab at the question?
Sure. In Canada, I would say that the vast majority of guardians who work on the management and protection of their landscapes and waterscapes are involved in some form of forest management issue. Though you may be aware that the reality of our boreal forest is that part of it is within commercial or formal management regimes, and the northern parts of it are outside of that commercial and forest kind of formal forest management regime. So some of them have forest management plans, and others it's more about the management of landscapes and wildlife dynamics and other things like that. I personally am a registered professional forester by trade, and I am still the author on the local forest management plan here in Labrador. It covers 7.1 million hectares, and of that, more than half is in protected areas, simply because of the delicateness and the reality that these are forests that require a certain amount of care. And our approach to forest management is to design for what needs to stay rather than to design for what needs to be taken. And that has completely shifted the way that the forest management plan looks like in this region compared to what it would have been had it been planned by provincial foresters and natural resources here in the province of Newfoundland and Labrador. That kind of Indigenous approach to forest management, in fact, we call it Indigenous forest management formally here in Canada to really try to look at this idea of planning for protection as opposed to planning for use, is something that has gone right across this country. And we find that in many parts of Canada. What we're seeing is that the forests that do implement that sort of forest management tend to be much more resilient to impacts like from climate change and fires and other measures. So I would say that it should be very much looked at globally as a way of thinking through how to both make sure that your communities can develop and benefit from the resources around them, but not to risk them at long term in a way that will affect the very values that make us who we are as Indigenous peoples, which is that value of care and that recognition that we are a part of these ecosystems and therefore cannot bigfoot or take more than what we should, because those consequences are not only direct in terms of the diminishment of the values, but also spiritual in nature. We have in our concept as Innu peoples, if we misbehave and use more than we are supposed to, there are serious consequences to that sort of behavior. And there are ways of translating the reality of that in forest management plans, and that's what we're seeing in many parts of this country.
Wow. Again, very inspiring words from Valerie. With that, I think we can close this panel. I invite you to give our excellent panelists a warm round of applause. And please feel free at this point to take your seats. Thank you very much, Valerie.
Thank you so much for having me virtually.
It's been our pleasure. And with this, I call up our second panel. That will be Suda, Jennifer, as well as John. In the meantime, we have a short video that we'll play as our colleagues are preparing to come up.
Namblo mi mundija ke panga mi manlo papa ninguni siblo huri tribe. Look, bagasat blo mi ikat primary forest time grand fundan time diwai fundan mi pro kolim ida pu tajenda history blo tu gudan blo mi yosem man brother blo diwai brother blo man and I past time or diwai and I past time and history blo tu gudan blo mi pro orsem na mi pro sawal duk dim primary forest good that's all now climate compete la na happy wari mi gam rando inside the world bro yumi this la primary forest e mi nom bro mi taso em bro yumi all get that inside the world think him this la so all what people you pro talk Indigenous people em mini no sem poor people na no got money place think him this la na you pro talk to taso now em good pro lo yumi all get that sep in primary forest I'm big plus something. International community, talk picture or some UN or European international people. In a funding some of money, law making, vanilla project or copy project or button back or all get something this can you me making. I'm you me protecting world pro you me. Something me pro no sabe, holding key pro, world bagraptas or you me stop time. Tribe now. Make him one him wena, protect him, make him this lakan. I'm employ you me or gataso. I'm stablo you bra. So me had lo talk to plenty. So me talk. Thank you, lo you bra. Merci à tous.
Mm-hmm. And this is a video provided by the Prince Albert II of Monaco Foundation. With that, may I call up our next panel of speakers, please? It's up to you. Sit where you wish. And I would like to start similarly to what we did with the previous panel. The topic or the theme for this panel is empowering women and IP leadership in forest conservation. So I would like to ask each of our speakers in turn to introduce themselves, what organization they're affiliated with, and what the work that they do is that relates to women empowerment and Indigenous leadership in forest conservation. So maybe we'll go in the order of how our panelists are sitting. Please, Jing.
Regan, do you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. My name is Jennifer Tauli Corpus. I am a Kankanae Igorot Indigenous person from the Philippines. And at this meeting, my hat is as a representative of the International Indigenous Forum on Biodiversity. And at COP16, I was part of the team that led the negotiations on behalf of Indigenous peoples on Article 8J.
Mm.
So I'll keep it there for now.
Oh, that's quite brief. Okay. Thank you.
Hi everyone. I'm Suda, and thank you organizers for having me giving this opportunity to share. I'm the country director for RECOFT in Nepal and manage and lead the country program portfolio that is basically looking after the biodiversity conservation work, the nexus of landscape and micro hydropowers, climate change programs, gender leadership programs. When all the program that we do in Nepal is kind of like the heart is like women empowerment and Indigenous people communities empowerment processes. That comes from our deeper analysis of the half of the population. I mean, especially in case of Asia and South Asia, the women and the Indigenous people are in the forefront of, the gardening, the use, the management of the natural resources. And without meaningfully engaging them in our work, we will not be able to address any of the climate crisis this is happening now, and we will not be able to reach the sustainable development goal. So that's how we have a deep realization of how we should be focusing our program, taking a transformative approach. And when I say transformative approach is like working with the communities, working with the women specific and with the IPs communities in two front. One, more taking like a push approach, which is like, taking this women, the Indigenous people to out of their boundaries, which is like giving the training to capacity build their skills, which are very technical when it comes to the forest management. May it be like the capacity to build their leadership skills, their communication skills, the comfort that they should feel when they work in a very patriotically systematic culture and society that they have in the community. So coming themselves out of that boundary is very important. So we take a push approach where we have a program of general grassroots gender leadership programs. And in these modules, we integrate a lot of, the time poverty and care analysis approaches, which them help to understand what's the time poverty will bring that challenge to the women and how they can analyze this to come out of the as a leader. And in this approach, we engage with a lot of youth, but also the household members, the husband, the in-laws, to be able to recognize what's kind of the role they could play to take that leadership role for the women. And then another pull factor, which is when we work pulling up, building an ecosystem and transferring that the leadership skills. By building the champions around. So we have a WAPES program, which is Waving Leadership Program, and that program is like identifying some of the youth, some of the policymakers, even like young professionals who could then build a change program, the change as a program to then further work with many of other women leaders in the country. But also engaging with academic institutions where we have like gender sensitive and responsive program in curriculum and a sensitive environment within the academic institutions. And we work with the private sector actors to come up with the women economic empowerment projects. So that's kind of ecosystem that we work. And then working with the policymakers and government actors to develop policies which will then have a mandatory provisions for women's provisions in the community forestry model where they can take that easy, the executive decisions and decision making processes can be in behalf of women and indigenous people. So working on both this transformative and approach where both working on both side of push and pull is very important for us. And as an institution we have like taken that approach in a way that we put it as our priority, one of the priority goals in our strategic plan. This is not just a cross-cutting for us. This is a core primary goal that we tend to have like a design of this program and projects when we do that, and it is built on in our integrated and mainstream in every project that we do. So this is how we take this, the leadership program in the country for targeting women and indigenous people. I'll keep it here. And
that's great. Thank you. So the push and pull approach to advocacy and mainstreaming gender. John, please kindly introduce yourself and how your work relates to the topics of gender empowerment and indigenous leadership.
Thank you very much. So my name's Jonathan Churcher. I'm the general manager of the International Ranger Federation. And I think firstly, we need to set the context of why rangers and why we link to indigenous people, because without that, we can't really continue the conversation of how we see ranger advocacy supporting indigenous people. So we use a term for rangers as planetary health workers, and that fundamentally includes indigenous people, forest guardians, and all sorts of other groups that work on the front line of conservation. We recently ran a report, the first global report called the State of the Ranger Report, where 30% of respondees class themselves as indigenous people. And so when we use the term ranger, we are very inclusive of indigenous people and what they stand for and what they do. We also are very aware that the role that indigenous people, without them, we will not simply achieve our climate goals or our biodiversity goals. We have set ourselves some very strong and important targets of 1.5 degrees and protecting 30% of the world by 2030. And yet, we sometimes find ourselves excluding groups such as indigenous people and particularly women in that. And we're seeing that there is not a strong female leadership position, which is disappointing because without that, we're not going to see the change that we need to see and has to happen. We also are very aware that when we include women and we include indigenous people, we see greater outcomes. The loss of, say, forest cover, for instance, is over 50% less in indigenous lands than it is in open and state-run areas. And so the numbers are really there of why we have to do this and what needs to happen. And the IRS role in this is really to represent rangers and in such indigenous people at these events such as COP, but also listen to that voice and connect from the lowest level all the way through and be that voice of the ranger from the ground all the way up to these events here.
Amazing. Thank you. Wonderful. With that, I would like to go around to a second round of questions. We'll start with you, Jing. In your view, what needs to happen in order for Indigenous people and local communities to be sufficiently empowered and supported to fully realize their global roles as stewards of forests and biodiversity? What else needs to take place?
Yes. I just realized I missed the second part of the question earlier, so I will talk about something that we've been working on as the International Indigenous Peoples and Local Communities Forum on Biodiversity. One of the reasons that we are here at the UNFCCC here in Baku is to share some good news coming out of Cali. and the COP there, COP 16. And we've been working really hard as Indigenous peoples to build consensus at the global level around the need for Indigenous peoples to be fully and effectively participating in all global policymaking processes that have to do with biodiversity protection, climate change adaptation, and mitigation. In August, we organized a global summit in Bogota because we knew that it was very important to build consensus among, you know, the Indigenous peoples of the world. We are coming from seven distinct socio-cultural regions and, you know, very, very different contexts and cultures. And it was very important to have this summit in order to level off on what our priorities are for COP16. And it was very clear. Our first priority was the establishment of a high-level body that would facilitate collaboration between Indigenous peoples and local communities on one hand, and governments and other actors, the funders, the academics, the academic institutions, UN agencies, and so forth. So that was one priority. The other one was a program of work for full inclusion of Indigenous peoples. Then, of course, we have the different funding mechanisms, like on digital sequence information, which is a little bit technical, but also resource mobilization and having a monitoring framework. And so with that process to identify our priorities and develop our proposals for COP16, we're very happy to announce that we've hit three of those five priorities. And the other two were only delayed because they had to adjourn the COP because of lack of quorum. It had gone over time and the developing country parties had to leave for their flights. And so we were not able to adopt resource mobilization and the monitoring framework. But the victories, the big victories, were the successful establishment of a subsidiary body on Article 8J. And this is groundbreaking within the UN system. If you see here in the UNFCCC, there are only two subsidiary bodies, one on technical and scientific advice, and the other one on implementation. We have never had a subsidiary body that looks at issues of Article 8J, well, traditional knowledge, and Indigenous peoples and local communities. And so this is a very, very important opportunity. We managed to adopt the work program, and we managed to establish to be part of the establishment of the Cali Fund for benefit sharing, from digital sequenced information on genetic resources. The monitoring framework very clearly included land tenure security as a headline indicator, which means that countries will need to monitor the status and trends of land tenure, especially for Indigenous peoples and local communities. It wasn't adopted because of quorum issues, but that's not controversial. It's going to be adopted at the resumed session of the COP. And so with this background, I think what needs to happen now is to make sure that this subsidiary body is alive and vibrant. We make full use of this high-level platform for collaboration with everyone. And we look at how we implement the work program. And in the work program, we have, for example, elements on the human rights-based approach. We have an element on full and effective participation of Indigenous peoples. And most importantly, on direct access by Indigenous peoples to finance for biodiversity conservation. And we believe that with this work program, we can have stronger implementation of the Kunming-Montreal Global Biodiversity Framework. And then also look at synergies between climate and biodiversity, because the reality is for Indigenous peoples, the actions that we take on the ground are both addressing biodiversity loss and climate change impacts. And so, you know, it's a very artificial division at the global level, this, desertification here, climate change here, and biodiversity there. No, so we want this holistic approach. We want to make more connections and synergies between the different processes. So that's what needs to happen. We need to have direct access to finance, and we need to support the subsidiary body.
Yes. Well, congratulations to you and the rest of the team for the amazing work as well. Moving now to Suda. So we've heard some of the successes with the WAVES program and the Gender Leadership Initiative. What are some of the practical on-the-ground challenges that you face with gender empowerment in Nepal specifically, And what are some of the strategies or ways that we could consider to overcome these challenges?
Let me start with some of the data that I want to highlight from Nepal. In Nepal, more than 51% of the population is female. Of that, only 64% are literate, and only 24% are owning land or and house entitlement. So you know, like you can already see the challenge at that level. I mean, literacy, having less, you know, technical knowledges around it, having limitations to access the finances with the land entitlement or the house entitlement here. Mm. But when it comes to the community forestry or the forest management, it becomes even more, because you know, like when you have this, the forest management, it always comes with a very technical measurements and terms, and where you know, women are hardly been kind of like taken up front to take that kind of responsibilities. But in Nepal, we have a community forestry model where more than 23,000 community forestry users groups exist, and 42% of them are women. But when it comes to, you know, like the participation, there is like, we can count the number, but when it comes to the executive body or the leadership taking positions, and then there we have a challenge, yeah. You know? So it's always like, you know, you do the work, but when it comes to the decision making, then there is someone else to do that job. And we have a very progressive, you know, the policy that actually helps to bring the numbers upfront. I mean, now with the policy of making like 50% of women participation in the community forest users groups, you have that number. But then, you know, what is happening? We have a deep patriarchal, systemic, you know, cultural norms there. So there is a pseudo, you know, like a representation. You are actually representing in number, but then your husband or someone from the house, your son, would go to that meeting and takes a decision on your behalf, you know. So that's the challenge that we faced. I mean, and another label, if we find a woman with our grassroots leadership program to come up with a leadership role, and you know, they really want to do that kind of all sort of leadership, you know, talks and decision making, then you know, because it requires a lot of time to networking, to go to these meetings, do all the works, and then when you come back, and then your family members will not be happy. Sometimes your husband abuse, you know, like so much of abuse and domestic violence is happening in the areas where even we are working. So you know, you have to. It's not just like, you know, the leadership program is enough, or the having that number is enough. It is very important to analyze that deep-rooted, you know, cultural norms and societal norms, and what's happening within that household or within that society that is not letting a woman. And in case of Nepal now, because of we are having this climate impact, we are having this, you know, like the hills are not producing enough, the livelihood is not enough. Now they have to migrate, I mean, from town, from a village to town, and town to abroad. So then what happening is, all the, you know, the females are left behind to do all the work. But this also means the time poverty. And you have now the triple or, you know, like full-time burdens of taking care of your family, your animals, livestock, taking care of your forest, your natural resources, and then on top of that, earning and going to these old economic interventions and activities. And on top of that, we will go there with our meetings, with our capacity building events, and so much of time poverty. So one of the things that we have, I mean, having these kind of challenges been kind of had, we integrated this care analysis work, which then having a household dialogue within the houses to see how you can distribute the roles and responsibility, how you recognize the role that's been kind of like new for women, and giving that, you know, space for them to kind of have a mobility, have a time to participate in the meeting, to actually meaningfully contribute in the process, and also meaningfully, you know, participate in a technical training which is long and which is demanding in that sense. Another is to look into, you know, how economically incentivizing the women, like if you are bringing some economic incentives to the house, then your perspective changes, you know. So it's kind of a motivational approach that we have also taken, like in some of the areas, that if you bring that economic incentive, it is okay to have that, you know, mobility, it is okay to have that leadership kind of role, and that again, it's kind of more acceptable to the family and to the society. So even taking an analysis that helps them to, you know, like more acceptance, but also, you know, like giving that space for them to have like the time, energy, and technical knowledge to be taking that advanced role. And what we also are kind of like proposing and doing in some of the areas, like, you know, power changer, you know, this kind of small, you know, work that is mainly male headed. So we're looking for, you know, the female to mm-hmm. challenge that stereotype and be engaged. And we provide that kind of training, which is actually economically very sound than, you know, like many other tasks you do in the community forestry thing. So it's basically, you know, full of challenges, I would say, mainly driven by the deep, you know, structural caste and societal norms that we have. But when we do integrate these as a core part of our gender analysis, then we have these kind of strategies. I would not say it may work in all the context, but in our context, it has worked and it has given the positive, you know, results and achievements in some of the area that we work.
Yes. Excellent. Thank you so much. Okay. Finally, last but not least, John. What needs to change in the narrative of traditional conservation, including as regards to the role of rangers, in order for us to achieve win-win solutions for both Indigenous people, for their rights, as well as biodiversity conservation? Whereas it's always been framed as binary, we know there's no way we can continue in that way. So what needs to happen?
Well, thank you for that. I'm just going to quickly just mention something which you've been speaking about. And just as the only man up here, it's wonderful being in the minority. But I think what you're talking about there are some much broader issues of equality. And it's not just about a number in the input to say, right, we've hit 50%, when actually internationally 25% or only 25% of legislators are women. So, you know, their decision making, or the proportion of them making decisions at the highest level, is not equal. And, you know, there is a huge effort to equalize that at the bottom, but we're not seeing it go all the way through. And I'd love to continue just discussing that as well. But on the actual kind of the narrative and how we go into a win-win, and, you know, not seeing this as a kind of a zero-sum situation where we do one thing and therefore it takes away from another. We've discussed it and it's been mentioned a few times, but the priority has to be Indigenous rights and sovereignty of the actual land and the areas that they're looking after. That has got to be the key piece, because without that legislation that supports them, nothing else can stand. And this is true, and I'm going to interweave a few range of points as well and around that, but that recognition has to happen. And then also the recognition of the ranger profession itself. And if we're, you know, we are including Indigenous peoples within the definition of ranger, and they include themselves in that, then we also need to see that level of recognition happen as well. And part of that needs to be looking at how we redefine and reframe the perception of rangers from enforcers to collaborators. And the importance that Indigenous people and women play within that role of collaborator and peace builder, because they're the ones who can bridge across into communities that many states and governments can't, because they either speak the wrong language itself or speak in the wrong type of language, that therefore they can't communicate and they can't work well with each other, and it causes conflict. And then we go into enforcement, where we should be looking at the collaboration from the outset. Thirdly, it's the knowledge transfer. The narrative has always been that we are going to do a thing, but actually we are, in doing that, reinventing the wheel in many cases, because the knowledge is already there. And we've seen this, Valerie was talking about it with the fire management, for instance, and we're seeing this in Australia as well, working with the Indigenous population there on how they manage their fires. And we're learning, because we reinvented the wheel in our image and we thought that we knew what was right, and it turned out that we were wrong. And it's been really great to see that change, but we need to do more, and that training needs to happen consistently. And finally, kind of my fourth point really is on the co-management. And you talked about this here, about how we tend to talk about co-management as almost like an end state. We're going to get to a co-managed situation, but we haven't done the co-decision making, we haven't done the co-inception, we haven't put the word co in the front of what we're discussing. And there's a delegate from Fiji who stood up in Colombia a few weeks ago, who made this point about how we need to stick the word co and prefix what we're doing with that. Otherwise, we're not going to get that shared decision-making at the very inception, and therefore we're always going to be playing catch up as we go through. And so the narrative needs to shift into be one that is more owned by Indigenous people, which is great that, you know, you're owning that narrative, and that's where it needs to be. And we need to be learning from you in how we do that, not just in how we manage these areas, but actually how we go about thinking about, you know, the management of them and how we go about the decision-making process. Because if only 25% of decision makers at the highest level are women, then we're not getting the best out of the situation. You know, we are always going to be playing catch up opposed to being on the front foot, because these issues are far too big to be solved, you know, in the traditional, I say traditional, in the modern sort of patriarchal way of thinking, and we're not going to get to our end states. So I think for me, you know, the narrative needs to shift kind of, you know, relatively wholly to be more inclusive, more diverse, but really from the inception all the way through, and that decision making needs to be owned by the people who really own the land.
Wonderful. Thank you very much, John. And I think with that, we can maybe see if there's any questions from the audience that you would like to pose to our panelists. Yes.
Jean, I want to ask, I am Carmen Rosa Guerrari Sangacancuama, Indigenous woman from Colombia. And I want to ask specifically to Jean about Target 23 of the Kunming-Montreal Global Biodiversity Framework and how this is connected with this main outcome of the subsidiary body of Article AJ. And I bring in this up because it's really important for the topic of the panel, and I feel that Jean can provide really good inputs about it. Thank you.
Yes. Please, Jean, do you have a microphone?
Thank you so much for the question. Indeed, Target 23 of the framework is about a gender-responsive approach to implementation of the whole global biodiversity framework. And this is, of course, very important for Indigenous peoples. And our main target is Target 22, which talks about land rights, right? The right of Indigenous peoples to lands, territories, and resources, access to information, access to justice, as well as full protection of environmental rights defenders. And we know that Indigenous women, women in general and Indigenous peoples in particular, are vulnerable in terms of all of those four elements of Target 22. And so it's necessary when you talk about land rights, for example, to make sure that Indigenous peoples are also, Indigenous women are also part of that. When we talk about environmental rights defenders, we have to look at the particularities and vulnerabilities that Indigenous women have. In our communities in the Philippines, in my region, up in the mountains, we are very rich in gold. And so the gold miners come, and frequently they use sexual violence against women as a tool to suppress protests from the Indigenous peoples. And so we have to recognize this particular vulnerability and be mindful of that when designing interventions that would support the rights of Indigenous peoples, so that we don't forget that there are particular circumstances of Indigenous women, Indigenous youth, and Indigenous girls that need to be addressed. And so thank you for reminding me that Target 23 is very important.
Wonderful. Thank you for the question. Are there any other questions from the audience in our remaining minutes? No. Okay. So I think with that, we can give our wonderful panelists a warm round of applause. Please feel free, I think, to head back to your seats. Just to summarize, I think we've heard some really great thoughts and perspectives on social inclusion, on, again, underscoring the importance of land tenure, on reframing multiple narratives, whether it's gender, whether it's the role of forest guardians, of rangers, and so forth. The one phrase that really struck me, we heard from Valerie, was to try to work towards developing the ability of our youth to hope for the future. And that really resonated, because I think that that touches a nerve with youth globally, given the current context that we're in with multiple crises taking place. So it's been wonderful to be a part of this this session. I hope you've enjoyed it. And we will end now on a final video message from the CEO of the Prince Albert II of Monaco Foundation. So thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, since the Paris Agreement in 2015, COPs have served as the primary forum for nations to unite and devise collaborative solutions to the urgent challenge of climate change. In these times of global uncertainty and complex geopolitical shifts, these gatherings shine as beacons of unity, reinforcing our shared commitment to tackling the climate crisis. His Serene Highness Prince Albert II of Monaco has been a pioneer among world leaders in addressing the environmental impact of human activity. Since the establishment of the foundation in 2006, he has championed actions across a wide range of areas, from Mediterranean to polar regions, from the global ocean to forests around the world, all to raise global awareness of the serious threats posed by climate change. The Prince Albert II of Monaco Foundation recognizes the essential role that these annual COPs play to advance planetary health. We are pleased to extend our sincere congratulations to the United Nations Forum on Forests on the creation of the Forest Pavilion at this year's COP29 in Baku. This initiative, realized with key partners including the Prince Albert II of Monaco Foundation and our Forests and Communities Initiative, offers a powerful platform to advance dialogue on forest conservation. Forests are the green lungs of our planet, absorbing vast quantities of carbon dioxide, regulating our climate, and sustaining an extraordinary diversity of life. Forests are also home to indigenous peoples and local communities whose traditional knowledge and practices are critical for effective forest conservation. By spotlighting the challenges that face these ecosystems and the need to empower the communities that inhabit them, this forest pavilion speaks volumes about our collective priorities. Let us work to keep forests at the heart of our climate discussions and actions. Preserving them is essential if we are to achieve a resilient, sustainable future. Thank you.
Thank you.